Oh, okay. They wasted no time before whipping out the emotional one this season. We're two episodes in, and the Hulu revival of Futurama continues to deliver. Sorry. Obviously, it's too early to say definitively, but I'm starting to get optimistic that this revival is going to be at least better than the Comedy Central run. Children of a Lesser Bog is a straight-up sequel to Kif Gets Knocked Up a Notch, an episode from the original Fox seasons. And obviously, it's filled with tons of callbacks and references for this reason, but my last video covered the season's connective tissues to the past as a good sign, so I'm going to skip that entirely. I'm sure all of you noticed all of the callbacks anyway. I'm pretty sure that this is the first time Futurama has done a sequel like this, which is something I do want to talk about, but looking down the line, episode 4 is titled Parasites Regained, which is clearly a reference to Parasites Lost, so I'll hold off until then. Instead, I want to talk about Futurama's notorious tendency to sucker punch you right in the feels. Sorry. While Jurassic Bark is obviously the most infamous tearjerker episode, it's by no means the only one. The series has been busting out emotional roller coasters throughout its entire history, but some certainly hit harder than others.
You're my parents! All I've ever wanted is to know you!
I'm going to highlight five of Futurama's emotional episodes, two from the original run, and three from the revival of the show on Comedy Central. There are more of these kinds of episodes sprinkled throughout the series, of course, but I wanted to focus on these, specifically because I think the earlier episodes succeed in a way that the later episodes desperately wanted to, but ultimately didn't. Finally, we'll take a look at Children of a Lesser Bog, and which of the two groups it fits into. But let's start with Fry, and his connection to the past. Futurama has used Fry's 20th century relationships as emotional fodder throughout the entire series. Cold Warriors and Game of Tones are episodes in the Comedy Central run that center around Fry's relationship with his father, slash son, technically, and his mother, respectively. Now, you can call me heartless if you want, but I think these episodes miss the mark. Considerably. They have the trappings of a Futurama emotional episode, but felt a bit hollow. Strange, even. Cold Warriors has a side plot where Fry's dad uses tough love in a bunch of unmotivated flashbacks that obtusely roll out the solution to the main plot of the episode. What could have been an excellent episode about the future dealing with a 1,000-year-old virus is this shit. They did so many visual match cuts that they had to move on to audio match cuts so you wouldn't get bored. And the only good thing about Game of Tones is the name, because it reminds me of the last season of Game of Thrones, which is the level of quality that we're looking at here. The episode features a plot that makes little sense. Why does a Niblonian ship FOB blow up planets? And furthermore, he triggers it while he's standing on Earth and Earth doesn't explode. So they were literally never in danger. They do some weird Inception thing, except time moves faster outside of the dream, except all of the timing seems way off because then they're all in the dream for a pretty long time and time doesn't seem to... Regardless, Fry relives his last day, and before this whole emotional arc with his mom, we get fed this line.
Maybe I just convinced myself I hated it because I knew I could never come back.
Get the fuck out of here with that. I mean, just look at how long it takes for Fry to unfreeze, realize he's in the future, and deliver this line.
Oh my god, it's the future. My parents, my co-workers, my girlfriend. I'll never see any of them again. Yahoo!
Took a whole lot of convincing there, huh? 30 seconds? The episodes try to establish some sort of unearned emotional catharsis between Fry and his parents. There's no tension to resolve because everyone's already over it. Fry's parents didn't give a shit about him going missing.
No one even cared that I was gone?
Not really.
And he was glad to be gone.
Yahoo!
His mother has never been shown to be anything but neglectful. And his dad? Well, let's just say I bet I know where he was on January 6th. Wasn't this video supposed to be about the new Futurama episode? Yes, and I'll get there. But my point is the Comedy Central episodes made an effort, but ultimately failed, to recreate some of the emotional gravitas in the original Fox episodes. The luck of the Fryrish, and I'm going to accidentally say Fryish probably a lot. Is the episode from the original series that Cold Warriors and Game of Tones appear to be trying and failing to replicate? The episodes do bear a resemblance. In The Luck of the Fryrish, we do see flashbacks into Fry's 20th century life, in which he has a complicated relationship with a family member, his brother in this case, Yancey. Yancey is central to the plot. Fry is trying to hunt down his seven-leaf clover, which it turns out Yancey took. The flashbacks in the episode are, for the most part, motivated. The first two happen when Fry is knocked unconscious, and the third is when Fry sees his childhood home for the first time in over 1,000 years. That's enough justification for a flashback. The last one, though, that's just a bullshit match cut to establish shit, but 3 out of 4 ain't bad. Where The Luck of the Fryrish truly beats its successors is in the final turn of the plot. Instead of just remembering for no reason that
maybe I do kind of miss this place,
Fry is actually presented with new information that he needs to reckon with at the end of his quest for his clover. The Philip J. Fry of the past wasn't Yancey at all. It was his nephew.
Named for his uncle, to carry on his spirit.
Fry doesn't just remember the good times with Yancey to resolve the plot. Fry discovers that he was loved and missed by Yancey so much that he named his son Philip and clearly told him enough stories that Philip grew up to be an embodiment of Fry's dream life. Maybe I identify with this story more because I have two brothers of my own, but I also have parents, so like, shit, maybe it's just a better episode. Luck of the Fryrish includes a legitimate emotional arc that makes sense for Fry's character, where Cold Warriors and Game of Tones are merely simulacrums of emotional depth that fall flat. And this isn't just limited to the episodes that focus on Fry, either. Leela's Homeworld and Lethal Inspection both feature emotional arcs for characters other than Fry, though it feels a little disrespectful to compare them. Leela's homeworld finally answers a question that has been in both the background and the foreground of the series since its inception. Is Leela the only one of her kind?
My parents abandoned me here as a baby, and I don't even know what galaxy they were from.
Lethal Inspection, similarly, is the long-awaited emotional payoff of Bender's relationship with Hermes. Or is it Hermes' relationship with Bender? It's hard to tell what they're trying to do with this episode because none of Hermes' motivations make any sense.
Here, Leela, take this and use it to shoot those guys.
Right, if they try to look in the box.
Whatever.
You're gonna tell me that dude cared about what happened to and happens to Bender? Furthermore, Bender was built at full size, so I don't know what this adorable thing is besides a blatant attempt to tug at heartstrings. As I've said, there are more episodes that take aim at your feels, and some of them, like The Bots and the Bees, and of course, the late Philip J. Fry, I think succeed. But a lot of the attempts at emotional episodes during the Comedy Central run of the series demonstrate a lack of understanding about what it was that made the originals work so well, instead getting hung up on individual ingredients like the non-diegetic soundtrack sequence at the end.
Chickadee, chickadee, fly through my window.
Which brings us to Children of a Lesser Bog, the latest in Futurama's rap sheet of emotional battery. Right out the gate, it's nowhere near the level of Jurassic Bark, Leela's Homeworld, or Luck of the Fryrish, but you can't tell me this isn't sad.
Please come home, Kimmy.
Children of a Lesser Bog has a lot of the core ingredients that give emotional episodes substance, while abandoning some of the more traditional trappings, like the musical sequence at the end.
When I see you alone, I see what's in your mind.
The plot revolves around Amy and Kif's kids, who are finally ready to emerge from the swamp they were born into 20 years prior. After the show gleefully kills hundreds of their tadpoles before they reach land, I figured this was going to be another goofy episode. That is, until the three that survived immediately walked up to Leela instead of Kif and Amy. It piles the weights on slowly, but over the course of the episode, shit gets pretty heavy. Leela, being the biological mother, while Amy is the Smizmar, create a unique dynamic specific to Futurama, but undoubtedly relatable to many people with non-traditional family structures. Amy is absolutely wrecked by the idea that her kids love Leela more than they love her. And who can blame her? Especially when the Grand Midwife returns with the threat of taking the kids away entirely. Honestly, worse. Can you imagine what it would have been like if Amy had to see Leela with her kids regularly? Which brings me to the second tragedy in the episode.
The Bond parents feel with their kids is intense. So I hear.
Did you catch that? She says the first part, looks down at the one-eyed baby, and smiles before saying, or so I hear. Leela feels a genuine connection to these three. Or at least, this one. She might have been a bit weirded out at first, but once she understood what was going on and got to know them, she took a real interest in the kids.
You are not their mom!
Actually, I sort of am.
I'm speculating here, but I feel like Leela would not have said that unless she had some genuine interest in actually being a mom to those three. And just as a quick aside, it's these three, right? This is Axel and Mandy bumping into each other and then Newt comes in. I mean, come on, it's gotta be, right? Anyway, I know Amy is lashing out pretty aggressively here, but she does provide context, albeit while yelling. But Leela and Amy are friends. It seems weird for Leela to push back like this without good reason. Things work out. Amy and Leela talk things out and they seem to be on better terms when it's time for the challenge, which turns out the whole thing was just a bullshit test put on by the Grand Midwife. She's like a bit of an asshole, huh? I hope that over time Amy gets more secure in her motherhood and she includes Leela more in the children's lives. So how does this episode compare to episodes of old? And episodes of old new? Well, it's got a little bit of both. For one, Amy's emotional journey is the A plot of the episode. It doesn't feel like it's awkwardly tacked on. This is, of course, in no way a rule. Plenty of side plots tell incredible emotive stories. But when Futurama bases the entirety of the episode around that one tug on the heartstrings, it seems to tug a bit harder. But that's not saying much. Lethal Inspection ties the feels right to the plot, and it still feels awkward because it's out of character. Here's where I think it gets complicated. It's hard to tell if this is out of character or not for Amy. Because if we're just going off of what she was doing during the Fox run, it's way out of character. And even in the Comedy Central episode, she's cheated on Kiff, she's juiced in an attempt to win at professional sports, organized a heist against the robot mafia, and was even late for her doctorate review because she was up all night partying. But Amy did get that doctorate, and Kiff was dead and broke up with her those times she slept with Brannigan and Bender respectively. That heist was to return the casino to its rightful landowners, and not her parents, but the native Martians. And it's pretty clear that everyone else in the Butterfly Derby was on Nectar, and she quit right before the championship. That might count for something. My point is, she was possibly showing signs that could have been interpreted as maturity. And there's the whole black box of the 10-year gap when time was frozen. Now, time was frozen, so she's not going to mature while she's standing there. But while that is true, the professor more than likely used chronotons to create the 10-second time button.
It's coated with anti-chronoton-resistant grout to shield you from the effects of the button.
Chronotons are highly volatile, and in Time Keeps on Slipping, we see that the professor doesn't always know what he's doing when it comes to these particles, or is careless at the very least. During the time skips in that episode, things played out as they would normally if time was moving forward at normal speed. Now, I'm not saying that this is what happened when time was frozen, but I'm saying we have no idea what happened. Anything could have happened. Chronotons are fucked, man. Stay away from those things. That's enough about chronotons. Let's get back to Amy. While I do think it's a little out of character for her, at the end of the day, I think it progresses her nicely. Whether we like it or not, the show is in 3023. And Amy did say,
"I'll be ready then."
Beyond that, what Leela says about the bond between parents and their children is true. I've heard. I'm at the age where all of my friends are just going ham on having kids, and it's like overnight sometimes. And while I'm not a whale, bear, or any kind of biologist, you can feel deep care for somebody without being biologically related. Like the original Fox episodes mentioned earlier, the emotional arc in this episode works because it's part of the main narrative and it's motivated properly. These reasons aren't limited in any way to Futurama, of course. That's just how good storytelling works. It has to go beyond just throwing vaguely relatable, touching images at the viewer and hoping they do the emotional math for you. Doesn't mean this episode isn't without cheap shots to the feels. The bizarrely gargantuan, for some reason, tardigrades are protecting what I think the animators think are cute baby tardigrades. Obviously, this is the parallel to Kif, who has three of his own at home, but the execution was clunky for me. Ultimately, I enjoyed the episode. Feels like it's on par with The Impossible's Dream, which was solid. Obviously not the Fox Run, and not as good as the rare certified banger from the other revival, but better than a lot of the Comedy Central episodes. Definitely the ones I mentioned. We're still waiting for this season's home run, but Futurama's always good for it, and the trend I'm seeing means it's coming. But there's gonna be some shit too. Comedy Central couldn't string together a ton of back-to-back decent episodes, and those dips were deep. Hopefully the floor on this season is high, but I don't think we've seen it yet. But I don't think we've seen the ceiling yet either. If you want, check back next week for my thoughts on episode 3, which looks like it's headed into some topical territory with an episode about a Bitcoin rush, which, I'll be honest, I'm a bit skeptical about. Anyway, thanks for watching. Bye.